Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is the 21st of March, 2018. This is the last Wednesday in our Lenten series. Next week is Holy Week. Sunday is Palm Sunday. Thursday, the 28th, is... Thursday is Maundy Thursday. Services will be at 2 and 7. Friday is Good Friday. On Friday, the 29th, services will be at 2 and 7. Easter Sunday, services are at 8 and 10:30. There's an Easter breakfast from 9 o'clock to 10:15, with an Easter egg hunt for the children during that time. Palm Sunday services are at 8 and 10:30 also. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Telephone number is 937-323-7508. The Reverend John H. Pollock.
Good evening, and welcome to our last Wednesday night midweek Lenten service for this Lenten season. Of course, next week is Holy Week, so services will be Thursday and Friday. We begin with Where Charity and Love Prevail, hymn number 359, in the back of your worship, hymn number 359.
Give us
this day our daily bread,
Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Show us your mercy, O God,
and grant us your salvation.
Give us the joy of your saving help again,
and sustain us with your bountiful spirit.
Give peace in all the world,
for only in you can we live in safety.
Keep the nations under your care,
and guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known above earth,
your saving help among all nations.
Let not the needy be forgotten,
nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create me a clean heart, O God,
and sustain me with your Holy Spirit.
Lord, hear my prayer,
and let my cry come out before you.
Lord, be with you,
and also with you.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously protected us today. We ask you to forgive us all our sins where we have done wrong, and graciously to protect us tonight. Into your hands we commend ourselves, our bodies, our souls, and all that is ours. Let your only holy angels be with us, so the wicked foe may have no power over us.
Amen.
This evening we have two readings from the book of Revelation. First reading is from the fourth chapter of the book of Revelation. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within, and day and night they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come." Whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall down before him who is seated on the throne and worship him who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, saying, "Worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And a reading from the fifth chapter of the book of Revelation. And they sang a new song, saying, "Worthy are you to take the scroll and open its seals. For you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God, from every tribe and language and people and nation. And you have made them a kingdom and priests to our God, and they shall reign on the earth." And I looked, and I heard around the throne and the living creatures and the Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Just prior to Christmas, a preacher went into the post office to do some final Christmas mailing, and after the young lady had helped him with the business he had brought in, she said, "Can I do anything else for you?" And trying to be funny, the preacher said, "Can you help me pay for my Christmas?" Without batting an eye, the young postal worker replied, "He has already paid." That stunned the preacher. It also delighted him, as well as kind of embarrassed him, that this young lady immediately responded with a word of faith and putting all of Christmas in perspective. He responded by saying something like, "Yes, he did," and having been embarrassed, walked out. But as he walked out, he realized how the young lady had put Christmas in perspective. That had Jesus not paid for it all, we wouldn't be celebrating. We wouldn't care about the birth of the baby in Bethlehem if Jesus had not died upon the cross that first Good Friday. So as we come to this last in our series on the cross for these midweek Lenten services, tonight we examine the worthy one. That is that Jesus Christ was indeed the one and only one worthy to take upon himself the sin of the world, and by giving of his life, paid the debt of sin that we owe, so that not only do we have victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil, but we also celebrate Christmas. We take that time to remember his birth as he entered God incarnate, Word becoming flesh, lived among us full of grace and truth, and we beheld his glory, glory as the only Son from the Father. And when, after 3 years of revealing what our Father is truly like, he then willingly went to that cross to be the world. Our two readings from the book of Revelation are making the point how Jesus is the Word. John, in his vision, is having this revealed to him, the glory of heaven, and how Jesus, through his actions on earth, is indeed the one worthy to be the Savior of the world. Revelation puts the life of Jesus in its proper perspective, that he came not for himself, but that he came to save the world. And what we learn from Revelation is Jesus is worthy, first of all, because he is holy. In verse 8 of chapter 4, the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and within, and day and night they never cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come." Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. The word holy, it's a Greek word that means to be set apart. It means to be separated for some type of special service. It means to be pure and to be blameless. It is the same word that in the writings of St. Paul and the other apostles is often translated when greeting the members of a certain church or community to which an epistle is written. The term saints is used. Because as followers of Jesus Christ, we are saints in the sense that we have been set apart. Set apart by God, claimed by God, the baptism, set apart to not only be followers of Jesus Christ, but but to be stewards of Jesus Christ's teaching and the message of salvation. That we are to pick up and finish what Jesus began with his earthly ministry. And so we are set apart. We're also separated in that we are the community of faith in Jesus Christ, the church, the body of Christ. Now, this does not mean, like the Hebrew children thought, that when God called them the chosen people, that meant that God only cared about them. And they forgot to share the covenant with the other peoples. And they began to think that the Gentiles were not worthy of God's salvation unless they became a proselyte, that is, a convert to Judaism. So as Christians, we are separated from the world in the extent that we do not follow the norms of the world, we do not believe in the gods of the world, but we believe in the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ for salvation. And that it is Jesus who is to be the motivator of our life, and it is Jesus who is to be the one that leads us in all that we do. But in Jesus' case, he also was pure and blameless, as the sacrifice had to be to pay for the debt of sin. Jesus was tempted as we are. Right after his baptism, the Holy Spirit lives united in the wilderness, and 40 days and 40 nights he fasts, and then here comes old Satan to tempt him, to try to have to derail God's plan of salvation. The devil was too dumb to realize he wasn't dealing with Adam and Eve again. He was dealing with the Son of God. He was dealing with the Savior of the world. And he was not going to be tricked by any apple or kingdom or power or anything else the devil wanted to throw his way. And so he is holy, which makes him worthy. Holy, and then he is pure and blameless. Of course, he's separated in, and he is set apart in that he's the Son of God and the Son of Man. The word Almighty means absolute and universal sovereign. It means there's nobody else. The Caesars can claim to be the rulers of the world. The dictators can claim to be rulers of the world. Kings can claim to be rulers of the world. England used to brag about having a son never settled the British Empire, because it stretched from ocean to ocean and sea to sea. But they weren't the absolute and universal sovereign. That is the Lord Jesus Christ. And that makes our Lord Jesus Christ the worthy, the one worthy, to free us from sin, death, and the devil with his death upon the cross. The second point Revelation is making again in the fourth chapter is that Jesus is the worthy one because he is the creator. As we read in verse 11, worthy are you, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will they existed and were created. The word worthy means to be deserving. It means to be suitable for a task. It means to be due a reward. What reward is Jesus due? The reward of our praise and thanksgiving, the reward of our love and our commitment. Because he has done everything for us and asked very little for us to do in return. Simply to follow him, to believe in him, to be his disciple. And so he was worthy because he was there at creation. The word created means to produce from nothing. Jesus was there. The earth was without form, and there was nothing but a void. And the waters were separated, and there was no earth in heaven. He was there, as we read in Genesis 1:26, when God says, let us Make man in our own image. Let us, not let me, let us, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the doctrine of the Trinity. And then John tells us that it's the beginning of his gospel. He was, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. So Jesus is worthy of being the Savior of the world because he is the Creator. He is the one that made the world, providing with all we need, so we might be his own and live under him in his kingdom. So he is indeed worthy, for he is our Lord and our God. And by your will, they existed. The word existed means for something to be, or coming to be. It means something happened. So you created, you caused to be the creation. You were there. So you were worthy to be the Savior of the world. Worthy to save us from sin, from death, and the power of death. And then we come to the clinching reason why Jesus is the Word. And that is where we turn over to the fifth chapter of the book of Revelation. And we concentrate on verse 9, where we read, "And they sang a new song, saying, Worthy are you to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slain, and by your blood you ransomed people for God. For you were slain." That's actually a very modest translation of the Greek word that's behind it. But the Greek word does not mean just slain. It doesn't mean killed in the sense of simply losing your life. It literally means to be butchered, to be slaughtered. In other words, Jesus' death was not just a death. Jesus was not just killed, but he was butchered and slaughtered by the sin of the world that he was making payment. He was butchered and slaughtered by those who rebel against God and try to work to undo God and his will. So the word is like what is used when we talk about certain kings, emperors, and dictators throughout the pages of history who ruled extremely brutally and who, when laying siege to a city, would not just capture it, but then after capture it, would butcher or slaughter all the inhabitants of that city for having nerve to rebel or to resist him, whoever that might be. During the latter part of the war between the states, General Grant, the victorious Union general, was referred to as the Butcher because of the high amount of casualties that were being caused every day by trying to crush Lee's army. But as someone commented to someone who made that claim, they said, "Grant's not the Butcher. Lee's the Butcher. He knows the war is lost, and yet keeps sending his boys into the fight when they have no chance of winning." So matters will decide your own as to who's the butcher. But we have those butchers in history that we know for sure. People like Pol Pot, the leader, present leader of North Korea, Adolf Hitler, Joseph Stalin. We go by the law, the Impaler, the Assyrians, others throughout history who were true butchers. Slaughterers of people. That is how Jesus' death is being described by the angels in heaven, which again shows he was worthy because by being slaughtered or butchered, his blood ransomed the people for God. That word ransom means to buy something, to purchase it. To free someone from a liability, it means to, or refers to Jesus paying the price, which binds us to him. Paying the price for sin, that binds us to him. No longer are we bound by sin, death, and the power of the devil. We are bound to Jesus Christ. Not by force, not by fear, not by trembling, but we're bound to him through love. We're bound to him through that great love he has for us. That he was willing to go through that awful death on the cross to save us. The word also means to redeem something. To redeem something is to buy it out from its present condition. And the word also has a meaning of to go to the marketplace. And how does that fit in with everything else this word means? Well, it's referring to, or it's the imagery of the Roman slave. He went to the market to buy slaves. And there were certain benevolent people who would go to the Roman slave market and buy a slave, or maybe even buy a whole family, and then they would set them free. That was called the redemption price. You were buying them back out of slavery by the money you were sacrificing to the slave. And so these people now were free. Well, Jesus buys us back from sin, death, and the devil, not with silver or gold, but with his holy and precious blood. In our own history of slavery, and I never knew this until I did some research, and I was shocked to discover that next to New Orleans, which was the biggest slave market in America at that time, Louisville was the second largest. And I had never heard that the whole time. Second largest slave market in the South. But anyhow, among the abolitionists, there were those who would go to the slave market, like in Louisville or New Orleans, and they would buy a slave or a family and set them free and then settle them up north. So that's why during the war, there were, at the outbreak, there were free Africans in the north who had become teachers or lawyers, farmers or whatever, because somebody had been benevolent enough to buy them back, to redeem them from slavery, to give them a life of freedom. Some probably went back to Africa if they did, but of course if they went back, there was always a danger of being recaptured and resold into slavery. So the majority would go north and learn some kind of occupation. That's redemption. That's ransoming people. Jesus paid the ransom. We usually think of ransom as kidnapping. Someone's kidnapped, a ransom is put out. If you want this person back, you have to pay this amount of money. Well, it's also that way with us in regards to sin, death, and the devil. There's a ransom on us. The blood had to pay for our freedom. And there was only one person whose blood could make that payment. Only one person who could ransom us from sin, death, and the devil, and that was Jesus Christ. And that is why in heaven they say he is worthy to open the seal. He is worthy of all praise and honor. On down in verse 12, he said, worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing. To him, in verse 13, to him who sits on the throne and the Lamb, in blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever. Jesus is the Word. The only one worthy. No human being, sacrificial death, could make up for the cost of sin. Sacrificing yourself would not make payment for the sins you have committed. There's only Jesus Christ. And because of that, because of Jesus doing this, and because of our faith in him, as John hears from the one talking, that Jesus, through by his blood, ransomed the people of God from every tribe, being an ambassador, being a disciple. And so Jesus is the only worthy one. He is the only one who can repay the debts. In these past weeks of this midweek service, each week, we have seen a different aspect of what Jesus' death on the cross meant and what it did. Tonight we come with a victorious heart. That through that death and then by his resurrection and ascension, it made him truly the worthy one for our salvation. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen.
You will notice that it has no music rhythm.
concludes our Wednesday evening Lenten service. Join us Sunday, Palm Sunday, at 8 o'clock and 10:30. And then next Thursday, Maundy Thursday, at 2 and 7. And then on Good Friday, 2 and 7. And then again on Sunday, Easter Sunday, April 1st, at 8 and 10:30, with an Easter breakfast from 9 till 10:15, and an Easter egg hunt for the children. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508.